Welcome back to the Windows 8.1 UX Design Jumpstart. I'm Chris May. I'm a user experience evangelist here at Microsoft.
Hi, I'm Martin Tieren. I'm also a user experience evangelist for Microsoft in the Netherlands.
And in this session, we're going to be talking about layout. And this is kind of a good place to kind of level set where we are so far. So at the start of the day, we talked about getting a general overview of Windows 8.1 and some of the experiences that you're going to be designing for, looking at them first from the user's perspective, then kind of diving into each and looking at them from a designer's perspective. And we talked about getting a concept for your app that's super focused, that's supported by scenarios and features. And then, from there, we talked about the different UI controls and the built-in-the-box kind of widgets. You can start to kind of construct your UI. And then to navigation, kind of understanding how to create a navigation scheme that makes it really easy for users to find their way, throughout your application. And now we're going to start laying out content and controls onto those pages in order to not only, provide those features and provide those scenarios end-to-end for your users, but also in a way that's really has a really nice, high-quality, and branded feel to it. So when we're thinking about layout, those are really the two different things that we need to balance or to think about when we're designing our app. We want our app layout to provide, a sense of quality and structure, as well as hierarchy and relationship between the different data and pages and so on. But we also want it to be, beautiful and simple and straightforward. So we want users to kind of, every time they open the app, every time they use the app, to be delighted with the way that it works and the way that it looks. And that's really the key for layout. So we're going to look through a couple of different apps here and just kind of tease out some of the elements of why the layout of these apps are great, whether it's from a structure standpoint or a layout standpoint or how they do commanding or just visual elements of it, just so you can kind of get a feel for kind of the direction that you're going to be going in with your app. So you can take that base Windows personality and how it does layout and commanding and really build on top of that to be specific to your scenarios and what your app does, better than any other app in the store. So I'm going to go to the Windows Store and just open up this app and go to the hub page here, via home. And you'll see here, we've looked at this app quite a bit, but you'll see here in the different sizes and weights of fonts, we're showing a relationship between data. We've got a really, really strong alignment to the grid, even though different elements within this app, whether it's this featured apps or these categories, or even different sized elements here, it all has a consistent layout, a consistent use of grid, and a consistent silhouette throughout the app. And then you can see other elements that kind of lend the personality to the app, including its color scheme, these subtle separators between the different sections and the colors that they use, having those angled lines kind of set off against the right angles of the grid. And if you start going into different sections of the app, right, you're going to see some commonality between those. Some commonality between the silhouette, even though the layout of the individual content items is different and is specific to the page. But you can kind of see that theme of size and proportion, stretching out through the app. And if you go up to this navigation bar, you can see that it's carrying through that green color, the default color for the Windows Store app. Right? And if you go into other apps like the reading list app, right? And we've talked about its use of color. Let me unselect these guys here for a second. We talked about, the use of color to not only give a brand to this app, this magenta color, but also the use of color to communicate something to the user. You can see, again, we've got a really great use of a type ramp to kind of communicate the information hierarchy of the title of the article versus the subarticle in the picture, right? This use of color at the top to communicate time moving back, so communicating not only the personality of app, but information about the app. And then, things like being able to have on-page commanding. So if I want to read this article, I just click on it, and it goes ahead and opens up, the news story for me to view, and I can switch between these different news stories just by, clicking on different news stories. Right? And it's a very nice, beautiful, uncluttered UI. And if I wanted to work with these items rather than having an edit button and a delete button and stuff like that littering every single content item, you know, I can use some of the commanding patterns within Windows 8.1. So I can just right-click on this guy and decide on whether I want to categorize it or clear the category or delete it, whether I want to select all or clear the selection. And it applies, you know, across multi-selection as well as individual selection, right? So some interesting details about having an uncluttered UI but still having the commanding that you need when you need it, right? And if you go to an app like, let's say, the Alarms app, right? And we've talked about this app over the course of the few different demos. You can see here I'm doing everything on page here, right? So switching through the different categories or the different features. You know, I can see exactly what they are. It's alarm, timers, and stopwatch. You know, if I want to add a new alarm, it's really clear to me just through on-page commanding that this is the command that I would click on to add that new alarm. You know, and this use of color and even the branding of the shape of the control, that dial control for communicating time, as well as the way that the alarm or the way that the control works. Very, very clear, very, very honest. Again, nice use of structure. They're doing some really cool things here with commanding of making this text box that I would use to name the alarm, right? Make it editable, right? Without having that box around it and stuff like that, so it just looks in line. Different styling of these controls, right? Rather than just being a plain old radio button, styling the control so the color communicates whether it's selected or not, and so on. Okay? So just a good example of some of these uses of, you know, color, grid, information hierarchy via a typeset or a type ramp of different sizes and weights of fonts, the difference between doing on-page commanding versus doing that transient UI commanding, and just some different ideas of, you know, how I'm going to communicate brand and how I'm going to lay out my app to support some of those scenarios. And all of these things are elements of layout that you'll need to get familiar with and you'll need to think about when you're laying out the pages according to what's my app going to be great at and how do I communicate that greatness through scenarios and through features. Okay? So let's talk about layout and talk about the different elements of a quality layout. So when you're just getting started with Windows, you're probably going to notice a few things that are going to be different from, like, you know, desktop applications or even mobile touch-based apps on other platforms. And the first thing is that the content itself is immersive. So it stretches from edge to edge, and we use every single pixel for what that app is going to be great at. And we provide composition, structure of composition, through a consistent use of the grid, the same grid that you would use, you know, in page layout or using layout for the web, right? And use the content itself to provide the structure and those edges of content to provide the structure. And doing that consistently across all the pages with a consistent, you know, silhouette for your app provides that sense of quality and makes it really, really look crafted. And when we think about commanding, we want to balance kind of that honesty and that discoverability with having commands on the page versus having the UI be clean and uncluttered, you know, rather than putting everything on the page and having it be very, very busy and very, very hard to see kind of the core scenarios and what's beautiful and useful about the app. Or on the other side of the extreme, putting everything in transient UI and asking the user to kind of hunt and find out where, you know, those scenarios or how they access those features. And we want to think about that not only from, you know, composition from the standpoint of commanding, but we also want to think about it from the standpoint of quality. We also want to consider touch when we're thinking about composition. You know, when we're talking about applications that might be used on big 23-inch screens like, you know, these devices that we have in front of us, or maybe even an 8-inch tablet that you carry around. Sometimes it'd have a keyboard, sometimes it'd have a mouse. How does touch affect the composition of the app? So we'll talk about that as well. Next, we're going to talk about typography and how a subset of font sizes and weights can be used to provide a hierarchy to your app. So you can see that this is the title of this news story, this is the subtitle, this is the subtext or the body of it, and how they relate to each other. And we'll do that in a way that's branded, so it's not only well-structured and high-quality, but it's also beautiful and visually interesting and lends a personality to the app. Just like we do across Windows and across all the first-party apps, you're going to have that sense, that sense of visual identity that's going to uniquely kind of call out your app and what it's about and why users love it. And it's going to be through color, and it's going to be through shape, and it's going to be through content. So let's look at just a quick example. And this is up on design.windows.com. And it's just a quick example of showing how you might take a design from an iOS app and migrate that design to Windows. And just as an opportunity to kind of call out some of the differences of how layout is approached between the two different platforms. So here you can see here's just a fictitious app photo journal, right? And I've got different stacks of photographs and, you know, that parchment paper background and the torn edge on the left side and so on. And one of the things that you're probably going to want to do just from the beginning is just remove the faux background. It kind of distracts from the content, and you know, no one really believes that that's parchment paper on the screen. They know it's pixels. So just make those pixels, you know, really clear and honest. The status bar, the title bar, and the menu, we actually don't need those. We're going to remove them and just use just move those features off the page. And any of the commanding for the status bar and stuff like that will communicate through the content itself. We're going to take the bottom pagination off and remove the stack photo metaphor. Again, just because that brings out clarity on the content and lets the content really shine these photos, your collection of photos from your family and friends and so on. We're going to remove that frame because it's just taking pixels away from, you know, those individual photos. And what remains here is the actual content. This is a set of photos for January and February and March and so on, right? It's just the actual content. And when we remove all those other elements, those other distractions, we're freeing up pixels that we can really dedicate to the great content in the app or the great scenarios that we have in our app. So we can make the photos larger, right? We can take those titles, and rather than just making them titles, we can make them navigational elements and make those navigable themselves, right? We can bring the content forward, like the titles of the photos and when they were taken, right? We can fill out the more content and use size and position to create a little bit of visual interest, right? And then take those section headers and make those navigations themselves and give the user a clue about the content itself, like telling them how many photos are in that book. There's 14 in this month and 235 last month. And again, since we took out a lot of those kind of faux elements of like the photo stack and the title bar and stuff, we can use those pixels to integrate more of the scenarios for the app into the hub page itself. So if we wanted to make this a social app and seeing like what all my social contacts were doing with commenting on my photos or maybe adding photos to photo groups that we both share, or maybe just, you know, adding comments themselves, I can add that back in.
And that's what you would expect, right, from a hub page?
Yeah, absolutely.
That you see the core scenarios surface there on that page and not have to look for the other scenarios somewhere in the app.
Right, because a great hub is all about drawing you into those scenarios. Yep. So if you launch this app and just see static piles of photos, it just feels like static piles of photos. They're just photos. Yeah. But taking something like this, like a scenario of my friends commenting, maybe they like that photo, maybe they want to know where it was from, or we have a conversation about it. If you surface that, like on a well-designed hub, it's going to draw you into that scenario. And then we have an opportunity to start adding some branding, just using like color and a custom font and a logo here to just add that visual design, that visual interest. So it all looks like an end-to-end branded experience. So just a quick example of kind of moving, you know, that design from iOS or from another platform you might be, you know, familiar with to the Windows personality. And again, this is, you know, based on just the personality that we describe in the UX guidelines. It's a great way to start. It's a great place to start. You know, you might be looking at first party apps like the Windows apps or from other partners. And you can see everything from the Windows personality that we built into the templates and build into the controls as being, you know, a great starting place, someplace that we reflect on our own apps, to being a jump-off point for creating something completely unique and creative that the world has never seen. But just as a quick example of that, so just you can kind of orientate yourself on something you might be more familiar with. So now let's talk about composition. And specific when we talk about composition, the first place that we really want to start is the concept of a grid, right? And using a consistent set of units and a consistent silhouette to create this clean and straightforward and consistent, you know, rhythm and structure to the application. And rather than, you know, relying on, you know, grid lines and controls like group box controls and stuff like that, we really let the content itself form that structure. So the crisp edges of the content and negative, you know, positive and negative space relationships can communicate details about the content and relationship between different elements of the content. This title goes to that picture. This content tile is different from the next content tile, and it's different from this other group. And we'll talk about using size and proportion and position to really emphasize and contrast relationships between different groups of content and use that in such a way that we can, you know, call out the brand new news story or call out the most interesting thing that's happening in that group of news stories that day and so on.
Yeah, I was thinking of this maybe can be compared to what we did with web development years ago with using tables.
Yep.
It was not that everything was in just in rows and columns,
right,
but it was a way to structure our page and to position things. Now we do it in a different way, but you still want to make sure that it aligns properly so it's easy on the eye and it's nice to see the flow on the page.
Yeah.
And that's the same with using the grid in the immersive apps.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, when we talk about the grid and we talk about laying out content or controls on the page, we don't necessarily want to think in pixels. What we want to do is we want to think in units. And in particular, we want to use 20-pixel units to lay out the content across that consistent grid. And the reason why we want to use units rather than pixels is because in Windows, we're thinking about designing UIs that look great, whether it's an 8-inch app all the way, or an 8-inch device all the way up to a 38-inch monitor. And they're going to have, you know, different, even on a, you know, two different 10-inch devices. One might be 1366 by 768, and the other one might be 1920 by 1080. So thinking about scalability, we want to think about these 20-pixel units because they automatically scale the whole numbers across the different DPI plateaus. And when we talk about windowing in the next section, this will really come to light. So you kind of just kind of trust me for right now that it's important. And then when I show you why it's important later, it'll be like light bulbs, like all across the world and using this jumpstart. And again, from the first session, we want to have a consistent silhouette. And we ship with templates that have a built-in silhouette. You know, it's so many pixels, 7 from the top and 6 from the right, and the content area starts here and so on. And that's a great place to start. But it's really about your scenarios and your content and how your silhouette is going to represent what your app is all about. And really the important thing is that it's just consistent across your app. You know, if you use the built-in template, if that's fine enough for you, that's a great place to start because, you know, that first pixel of where the content's going to start and the first pixel of where that header is going to be and where the back button's going to be, that's going to be consistent, you know, amongst a lot of apps. But if it's something that your app, your scenarios, wants to move away with that to really make your content and scenario shine, then absolutely do it. Right? And just like we had talked about earlier today, that consistency doesn't have to mean rigidity. It doesn't have to mean a monotony. It can be very dynamic and very interesting. Just like you're seeing here, this is an app that is using a consistent silhouette, but in some cases, breaking away from that silhouette, like this guy, the soccer player in the center, and that soccer ball moving, creating a sense of just dynamic motion, right? That really, as a fan of soccer, kind of makes me think about all the great soccer games and all my favorite teams, right?
Yeah, and it's thinking about this, especially what you showed before, like going from an iOS app to a Windows app.
Yeah.
There's a lot of design aspects in those apps, and you can bring that over to the other platform. The only thing is you want to make sure that users familiar to the Windows platform know how to use that app if they didn't know it before. And that's by just using these kind of guidelines to help users out to know where they can find specific things.
Yeah, it was just like we were talking about in the first session, we were talking about that mixture of that creativity and uniqueness, but also having it feel native, right? And silhouette is a great example of that. Right? And then I can start to tune things using that same grid and using that same silhouette, just like we saw on the store app right, where you've got, you know, that top section of the featured apps and then different groups of different content. I can start to play with positive and negative space to show different related items versus unrelated items, so I can see all the items in one with that, you know, little 10-pixel or 20-pixel negative space between them. I can see that those are all related. But I can see with this 80-pixel space, negative space between group one and group two, I can see that those are two unrelated different groups of items. So using that positive and negative space to my advantage to communicate something about my content without, you know, falling back on having, you know, controls and grid lines and lines that are kind of cluttering up the UI and distracting from my app. And then I can use size and proportion, right? And you see this in a lot of apps on the hub page where they're communicating what's the top news story of the day, right? And calling out that big hero image and then maybe some other still important but not as important stories, you know, maybe calling those out with, you know, slightly smaller boxes versus, you know, just lists of items. Like you might see, you know, one being the most important story of the day, two being the...
It's like the background in the studio here.
versus two being like a still, you know, another a couple of important stories versus three being kind of lists of stories you might dive into more deeply. Right? And then position. When we think about apps, just like we think about, you know, above the fold for a newspaper or that, you know, first pixel on a web page, that first upper left-hand pixel in a Windows Store app is the most important pixel because that's where everybody looks first when they go into the app. So you can use position to kind of tune and communicate something about what's the most important content element on that page. Okay, and you see this as you go through various apps, and you as a Windows 8.1 user, you know, you'll see this in applications, and we as designers will start to kind of decompose and think about, you know, what are they communicating through the composition of these various apps. Like here, Angry Birds Star Wars is the most important, that's the featured app that you see, you know, first thing when you go into this app, right? And varying the layout and the size of content to kind of communicate, you know, popular now, calling out, you know, even more details about those apps versus maybe a smaller list where you're just calling out like the name and the star rating for it, right? But it doesn't have to be, you know, boring and rigid. I mean, this is the search hero page that you're going to see when you start using Smart Search. And you can see here there's an interesting rhythm and layout and use of color within this page while providing a structure and highlighting this content like the photographs and the videos. But it's still really, really interesting and has that kind of structure while still kind of drawing me into the content, right? Okay. And we've looked at reading list here where I've got, you know, a grid of news stories and I'm kind of breaking them up and providing a different rhythm to the page just by varying their size, right? And calling out the last thing I added, you know, because maybe that's what I want to click on right away and get started with that news story. Okay. So thinking about the grid and thinking about composition in a silhouette is important, but we also need to think about how the device is being used. And for Windows 8.1, it's a touch-first experience. It supports, you know, keyboard and mouse. So I need to think about ergonomics of touch within my applications. And like we had said before, you know, the built-in platform and the controls, they all support touch and keyboard and mouse and pen. You know, if you design for touch, you get the rest of that just for free. But you do need to think about ergonomics as well. And one of the things that I look at when we're doing design reviews with folks is thinking about interaction versus reading areas and thinking about how people hold devices, you know, by the edge with their thumbs right on the bottom. So for an interaction area, if you look at this graphic, you can see the difference. And if you think about this logically, the difference between, you know, what's the best surface for doing commanding? Well, it's down there at the bottom where your thumbs are going to be that you can get at very, very quickly without moving your hand. That's why the app bars are at the bottom. Those commands gravitate towards the edge. Versus some of the areas like that light gray in the center, might be a little bit better because I only have to, you know, move one hand and it's just a little bit. Versus up at the top, that darker gray area might be a little bit harder and there's going to be some inclusion for interaction, you know, as I move my hand over there to touch any commands that might be up there. And that's fine for things like navigation I'm only going to be doing every once in a while versus commanding I might be doing a lot more. So we put those on the bottom edge.
And of course, it also depends on the scenario for your app. Maybe what kind of device is used or how you're holding it or...
Yeah, exactly. And for reading, it's kind of the inverse is true, where that top area is the the best part for reading, you know, because it's above the sight line of the app. It's not obscured by any commanding that you have in the application. And thinking about that, whether it's, you know, your landscape design or your portrait design or even your windowing design is going to be really, really important. Okay. Statistically speaking, most people are right-handed, so you need to think about that as far as in a right-to-left language. Think about occlusion and thinking about where people are going to be placing their hands and how they're going to be moving them as far as, you know, occluding some of the content or some of the controls on the main UI area.
Well, most creatives are left-handed, right?
I know. Yeah, so it's that subset, right? Statistically speaking, the world, but then all of us creative geniuses are all left-handed. And actually, I should put my watch on the other hand so I can sign off on being a lefty as well, which... Are you left-handed?
No, I'm right-handed.
No, geez.
I'm a strange one.
We're the ones that prove the rule. Okay, so next we want to think about targeting. And think about targeting within your apps. Now, Windows 8 and Windows 8.1 were built on a really, really intelligent, really well-engineered targeting system where they use the whole finger to determine what the target is rather than trying to treat it as a mouse that's, you know, very precise, you know, crosshairs, I can click on this pixel. I mean, fingers are sloppy and they're different shapes and stuff like that. So you want to think about how to design targets for that touch experience. And Windows makes it really easy for you just by building it into the platform. You just need to think about target sizes and your target audience and finger sizes. So when they touch on that button, they touch that button and the success rate is really, really high and kind of matches the scenario. And what do I mean by that? Well, it's about target sizes. So we collected a ton of data, purchased some data from the U.S. government to collect information about what were the best target sizes for touch elements. And we found the sweet spot. If you start to compare the percentage of missed taps or unsuccessful target hits versus the size of the element, we found that 7 millimeters or 40 pixels is really the recommended minimum size. And it resulted in about 1 in 100 or 1% of the times having that missed target for your user. And this is a spectrum, right? So you need to think about your scenarios and think about your target audience and kind of tune from here. But that 40 pixel size is kind of that recommended minimum size just based on the data that we had collected. And this is what we use in a lot of our apps as well. Okay. Now this is kind of interesting. This is comparing the size of a baby's finger at 45 pixels versus, like, let's say a basketball player's finger that's like 100 pixels, and the average being 60. There is a spectrum there, and it's really going to depend on, you know, maybe you're creating a children's game, or maybe you're creating an app for a specific audience, like
for basketball players.
Yeah, exactly. It's funny because I actually did an app for athletes, and we did the first mock-ups and stuff like that, some first prototypes, and handed it over to the users, and they were football players, and the touch targets that were very reasonable for us were not reasonable for them because they're, you know, above average, very, you know, large, muscular, huge hands, and it didn't quite work, so we had to tune from there, and it was... For that particular app, it was just for, you know, the players, so we had to adjust accordingly. But if you use that 60 pixels as a good starting place and then start thinking about your scenarios, this data can be very, very helpful in determining your target sizes. Okay? So if we talk about the minimum target size as being, that recommended target size as being 7 millimeters or 40 pixels, you have about 2 millimeters of padding or 10 pixels between targets. So the heart-to-heart between those two is going to be about 50 pixels. And that's a great place to start. And you might tune that according to the scenario. Like, if it's low consequence and it's no big deal that I, like a checkbox that I check or uncheck, you know, if I see that, I accidentally hit it and didn't mean to, you know, you can make it a smaller size and fit more content onto the page. If it's a high consequence thing, like, you know, transferring, you know, a bulk of money, are you sure, like, you know, to complete, like, a bank transfer or something like that, maybe you want to turn up,
there's,
you know,
the bank again.
Yeah, exactly, the bank example. Maybe you want to tune up the size and make sure that when people hit that target, they really intended to hit that target, right? So again, it's thinking about scenarios, and these guidelines are just a good place to start. So now that I know I've got this well-structured layout and I'm thinking about the grid and silhouette and I'm thinking about, you know, the impact of touch on ergonomics, next thing I need to think about is commanding. And we've been talking about commanding over the first few sessions. We were really talking about that balance between a core scenario and a non-core scenario. So let's dive into that a little bit and think about page layout. So core UI elements, put those on the page, right? Make your app clear and simple and as straightforward as possible. Now for non-UI, non-core UI elements, you have the opportunity to move those on a page in a way that's still going to be easy for users to find, like on an app bar or a flyout, or you know, connected to the charms, right? In a settings flyout, right? And by doing this, you remove that clutter and get clarity. So you don't even have to think about discoverability because everything is so clear and so simple within your UI. And what you're doing is, rather than solving for discoverability, you're just removing the distractions from the start. So it's your app is really great from the start. And I think, you know, we were talking about less is more earlier today. That was really that kind of an idea of understanding what your core scenarios are and build everything about those core scenarios. So it's really easy for you to see kind of that balance on what goes on the page versus what might go on an app bar.
And help users to focus on the content.
Yeah, exactly.
Not in all the distractions.
Right, exactly. So that being said, we need to think about how do we design those app bars, right? Well, we just apply the same layout rules that we've been talking about over the past few slides. There's just a couple of things that we need to think about with the way that the app bar itself works. So we start with user flows, our scenarios, and our features, right? And from there, we're going to organize our commands into command sets. So what commands should appear throughout the entire app? So just being global, always there, like add new content or something along those lines. What commands should appear only on specific pages, like maybe buttons for filtering and sorting on a list page, right? And then what commands are contextual? So if I select an item, what commands do I want to show to work with that item? If I select multiple items, what commands should I show? And then, you know, what commands might be better served by moving them off to being like a settings, in the settings flyout or something along those lines. Once I've got those commands organized, it's really easy for me to see, you know, command sets that I can create and move those to the app bars, right? So when we're thinking about app bars, there's a common set of glyphs that ships with the Sago UI symbol font that ships in Windows 8.1. And you can see here, like the back button, the add button, the check mark for confirming something, the two arrows spinning for refresh, the dialog bubble for comments. These glyphs ship with the system. You can use them within your app, and they're instantly recognizable by users, right? So they automatically know that thumbtack means pinning. So you can use those, just like a lot of things we've been saying over the past couple of days, you can use those and style them and color them to match the rest of the branding in your app. Users will instantly understand them and instantly know what they mean, right? If there's something that you want to do that's unique and crazy to your brand, you can, of course, do that. Then you have to supply the content with that. We'll talk about that when we're talking about the windowing later today. But if you use these glyphs, they ship in the system, they automatically scale well, they're instantly recognizable. And you can just leverage them in a way that's going to make your app easier for users to use. And there's some common command glyphs that we see that are consistent across apps. And again, that consistency just breeds familiarity for your user. So the plus sign is always add. The minus sign is always remove. The hourglass is always search. Users are going to learn this once, and they're going to be able to feel familiar with your app if you leverage these commands in that context. Okay. So when I'm thinking about command layout for the app bars, I want to think about really three things. I want to think about predictability, right? So I want the commands to always show up in a consistent way across the app so I can kind of leverage muscle memory as well as providing that feeling of quality when I'm using the app. So I always know the add button's always on the right, you know, all the way to the right-hand edge. I want to think about ergonomics, think about people holding the device, you know, and having their thumbs at those bottom edges. And then I want to think about, you know, aesthetics, is making it very, very clear and easy to see, you know, what those commands mean and tying them to the context that the app is being used. And here's an example. So persistent commands always go on the right. So if it's a global command that's going to go throughout the application, if you always put that on the right-hand edge, users will always know that wherever they are, if they want to upload some new photos, like in this photo app, they're just going to grab from the bottom or hit, you know, Windows Z or right click on the app, and that command is always going to be under their right thumb, right? And that's just a quality, consistency, predictability kind of thing for your users, right? And they appear throughout the app that way. Now, new and add and delete and remove are always at the far right, so users will kind of see some consistency even amongst different apps, right? And again, that's a predictable experience that they'll see as part of just kind of the Windows personality across different apps. And again, they're always going to be an easy reach for that swipe and tap. But I also want to think about the edges as well, right? So rather than just loading up that right-hand side to the point where I have to take my thumb off, you know, that right edge and start, you know, hitting different command buttons, if I move different command sets, like take like a page-specific set of commands and move that over to the left-hand side, then I've still got them within easy reach of my two thumbs, right? You know, the more common ones are on my right hand, and the page-specific ones are going to be on the left hand. And again, they're really, really easy, and they're really accessible even when I'm just holding the device from the edge. Now, I might get to the point where my app bars have tons and tons of different app bar buttons on them. They're going to start to look cluttered. And generally, in the apps that I've designed, it's right around that 10 mark, right, where I have 10 app bar buttons, that it starts to look a little bit a little bit cluttered and a little bit overwhelming to users. So what we can do is we can use flyouts associated with those commands to really reduce that clutter. So if I had, you know, I had sort by, let's say I was looking at restaurants and it was sort by distance and it was sort by price and sort by, you know, cuisine or something along those lines, rather than having three buttons for that, I could have a sort button that you clicked on that showed a flyout that I could get, you know, pick how I want to sort them, right? Just like if I wanted to do a comment here, right, I've got a little flyout where I can go ahead and make that comment and that I don't need that UI always on the page and it's always there and always available. Okay? Hiding disabled commands is another common pattern for app bar buttons where if they're not relevant to the page, don't dim them and leave them on the page. Just remove them, and users will quickly learn how to select an item to get those commands that they're going to be using. Or if they're only specific to the view, they'll expect when they switch views to see the right commands at the right time. It reduces clutter, but again, very, very predictable. Now, if I'm selecting content items and I want to provide commands associated with that, like we did in the reading list app, or even, you know, when selecting tiles on the start screen, you want to show those commands always on the far left. And if you already have like page-specific commands there, have those move in, provide a separator, and then insert those commands on the left. And that kind of matches that strong context. The user's told you something very specific when they selected that content item. They told you that they want to work with it. So putting those commands all the way on the left-hand edge, again, easy reach for the thumb, makes it really, really easy for the user to work with that command or work with that content that they told you they wanted to work with. Right, so here's the app bars for example, the weather app, you know, where I can change my home, I can do the navigation, you can see all the commands are nicely placed on the edges there. I've got a command bar here that's a custom command bar rather than using just the out-of-the-box command bar button, so I've got different controls, and I'm just using, you know, the same layout grid and positive and negative space that I would use for laying out any content within the UI. Here I just happen to be doing it in an app bar. And then really I want to think about personality within my app, you know? So if I'm, a painter and I'm used to working with an easel and different brushes and tools and stuff like that, reflecting that in the app as far as the personality of the app is just a great opportunity to make something that, you know, feels branded and feels consistent with the scenarios of the app, like you can see here in Fresh Paint, having that easel come down, let me mix colors and see exactly the results and change brushes and change how the brush works. It's just consistent with the app, and it really provides a great personality of the app, the way they're using color and the ways they're using shape here.
Yeah, and this is not an app where you would just hold a tablet and have your thumbs on the side, right? This is a very active app because you're painting and you're doing something. So you have a different layout of your controls. That's okay for that situation.
Yeah, it's all about scenarios, right? Start with the guidelines, think about how they apply, or maybe don't apply to your scenarios. And it's really about, you know, thinking it through and maybe doing some prototyping and some A/B testing with your users. And you're going to find that the guidelines is a great place to start, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So next we want to think about typography. And typography was just a core element of Windows from the very beginning. We were talking about the principles of craftsmanship. We really want a type to be clear and beautiful and easy to read throughout the system. So the type system within Windows is incredibly strong and incredibly full-featured. And we wanted to make it so it was not only beautiful to read and easily scaled and so on, but we wanted to provide typography as a way to provide structure and rhythm to the app. And really we do that by using a subset of fonts, sizes, and weights in order to communicate an information hierarchy. So you can see, you know, this is a article that has a title and a subtitle and a date that it was posted and some body text, and you can see the relationship amongst all of those different elements.
Yeah, or the other hand, what we've seen in the Alarms app,
right?
Where the alarm, the time is very important.
Yes.
That's bigger than the rest of the content.
Yeah.
Because that's what the important part is, where the focus is.
The app is about time, right? That's the most important thing that you could be calling out on the screen. So again, we want to align the type on the grid. And here you can see is the base type ramp that we build into the templates for Windows 8.1 that you see in Visual Studio and in Expression. And notice the size here. They're about half as you're going through from one typeset to the next. And notice also the alignment of each one of these type sizes to that 20-pixel grid. And this is really important because when we talk about windowing, we talk about DPI scaling, all of these font sizes will automatically scale across the different DPI plateaus without rounding or partial numbers and so on. So they'll always come out to be whole numbers and they'll always look great regardless of the screen size of the screen DPI. So we used this example this morning. We were talking about design from a very, very high level, and you can see this dialogue just by tuning a little bit of the typography and a little bit of the composition on the grid, making the dialogue very, very clear on the information that's being communicated to me and the decision that I need to make as far as buying more SkyDrive capacity. Okay? So, fonts that ship in the system. Sago UI is an example of one of the fonts that we ship with Windows, and it's built into the base personality as far as, you know, what we use as the start or base personality for all of our first-party apps. It's available to you. It ships in the system. It's built into the templates. You're more than welcome to use it. It's distributed with Windows, so you don't have to worry about licensing and stuff like that. And it was really, really tuned for screen readability and use in mobile applications. If it works for your brand and it works for your scenario and the personality of your app, absolutely use it. Right, Calibri is another example of an app that, or a font that we ship with Windows that you can leverage in your app for reading, as well as Cambria is a great app for doing like reading large amounts for like reading apps, like a reader app or a news app, and so on. And you can see that we have a bunch of different fonts that we're shipping to be used in various languages, and have all the benefits of the native fonts built into each individual font. Like, these fonts are optimized for screen display as far as their cap height and their X height and the counter and the baseline and the descender. And whether it's, you know, a serif font or a sans serif font, again, all of this was tuned to make it look incredibly crisp and incredibly clear using the typography engine of Windows.
I think it was during the first build, that was 2009,
mm-hmm. Yep.
That was a presentation of someone who was on this font team. And it's incredible how they're like pride in craftsmanship, have eye for detail and thinking about the pixel and where the little line is. And there's a lot of tuning and research behind those fonts and how they display in the screen.
Right. And you get that all for free just by using any of the built-in fonts. And it's again, one of those things that you need to think about your application and your scenarios. What do you want to kind of get for free and just leverage from the system? And what might you want to tune and change to reflect something about the personality in your app and use your own custom font, right? So the benefits of the native fonts, as I had mentioned, they're optimized for localization. They're licensed with Windows 8.1. And they've got open type features such as kerning and literature. Jeez. Is it too late or early in the day to say ligatures? Ligatures.
It's your session.
Yeah, thanks. Let's hear you say it. And stylist sets to really tune the font for typability and for readability. You can see here just adjusting on that word type on the left versus type on the right, just adjusting the kerning between those two different fonts or those two different
letters,
the characters, and having it tuned based on what characters are next to each other can really increase the type of or the readability of that type. Okay. Of course, you can use other fonts. Just use a consistent type ramp. Use a small set of font sizes and weights and colors, so it's consistent across your app and has that quality feel for it. Make sure it's a font that's tuned for screen readability, and make sure that it's licensed. We've got a URL here that you can get some information about how to embed it and redistribute a licensed font. Okay. So now I've got a nice structure to my app, and it's all aligned to the grid. It's got a great it's got a great composition and silhouette, and I'm using typography to kind of communicate an information hierarchy. I've got a great balance between core scenarios on the page and then, you know, sub-scenarios being in transient UI. So now it's about personality, right? And branding is all about personality. So across any application, you're going to have that gradient statement, the scenarios and features, and you're going to be having a conversation about, you know, how do I express the brand of this app? How do I differentiate this app? How do I, what's the right way to represent color and shape and font, animation, and even copy within the app to really reflect what that app is all about? And that's what branding is. And you can use color, you can use graphic elements and content like images, glyphs, and so on. Layout across the grid, how the app is structured can communicate personality, the logo and how I present that within the app and throughout the app, and then tuning type, right? So what's the right font to use for my app? Do I want to use the built-in fonts, or is it something like New York Times where I have a very specific font that's very clearly tied to my brand and the experience that I want to provide? And here's an example, and I like this example quite a bit. This is from design.windows.com, and the team did a great job of kind of, well, really like calling out the difference that these branding elements can make within an application. So here we've got the same set of content across a bunch of different branding exercises, and this is just the built-in templates where I've got, you know, this field guide content for, you know, exploring in nature, and I've got these different images, right? And if I pan through, I can see different flowers and vegetables and rocks and things like that, rock formations and so on, right? And here's a detail page with a picture. It's a great picture, you know, of this meadow with all the flowers and stuff in it, but it honestly just looks like the templates, right? It just looks like, you know, someone came in and started binding some data to the templates, and that's great. I mean, this app would work and you could get it in the store, but is it going to excite people? And is it going to draw people into the application? Well, probably not. But let's do a little bit of tuning, right? So in this example, we've taken the exact same content, moved to full bleed images, worked with size and proportion, started working with the size of the font as well as the color of the font to create a theme with even, you know, that's the same content is much more exciting and visually draws you into the app. All right, here's that same page for spring, right? And these graphical elements kind of having these angles offset from the right angles of the content itself, calling out kind of the saturated color of the gray and offsetting that against the very natural view of the leaf and those droplets of water. Again, they're just visually interesting and they just draw me into the application, right? Again, offsetting the pixels of the font and the color versus these natural photographs. It really draws me into the application. And here's another example where we're using kind of offsetting some saturated colors against, you know, that are very digital versus the very, very analog of some of these other pictures like these mollusk shells and those rock formations. Again, this is just the same content, and we're just tuning layout and branding to really change the personality, right? Here's another detail page, just using these angles and offsetting these different images and comparing that to, you know, the font. Again, calling out some different angles to kind of make some visual interest here. Here's another version of the field guide where they're using real photographs and then relief marks for different elevations, kind of calling out that feel of a map that you might be using to navigate throughout, you know, this nature preserve, right? And it's all the same content, And just using like here color, different sizes of fonts to reflect a really interesting personality within this app. And finally, here's another one that you're using kind of these sepia tones and these kind of really cool and relaxed colors to kind of communicate a completely different feel just using the same content. Okay. So it's something you really want to think about within your app, and that how you're going to brand your app to communicate the personality of the app. So when we think about layout, we want to think about kind of that yin and yang, left brain, right brain kind of a thing, where we want to think about not only structure and hierarchy and use of the grid and that consistent silhouette, but we want to think about beauty and personality, right? So composition provides the structure. I use the grid, I use the silhouette to have that crafted, high-quality feel. I start aligning or placing content using positive, negative space and using the edges of the content itself to kind of provide that uncluttered, clean, context-centric layout. And then when I start thinking about commanding, I think about that balance, you know, of commanding that goes on the surface versus that goes on the page, again, very simple and uncluttered versus something I might do in a transient UI, like an app bar or a flyout, where it's only the user only has to look at it when they want to look at it. It's easy to find. They know where to find it. And then for typography, provides information hierarchy. So we use that subset of sizes and weights of fonts and apply it consistently across the app to communicate relationships between data and hierarchy within the data. And then using branding it to convey personality. What can I use for color and graphical elements and fonts to really tune up the personality of that app and really draw people into that app and what it's great at. Now, if you want to play around with this at home and try and, you know, go through the design process itself, we've got a lab here that you can do where you go through and take, you know, from the last session, you probably have an information architecture and you have a pretty good feel of how the hub page is going to relate to list page, is going to relate to, you know, detail pages and so on. So in this lab, maybe go out and sketch a silhouette of the app, including the header, the margin, the footer, the content area. You're going to use what's built into the templates, kind of that default silhouette, where you're going to tune it for your scenarios. Then sketch the content area and take a few key pages, like the hub page. Can you see how you would get through all of your different scenarios within the app? What goes on the page? What goes off the page? Maybe draw the app bar down at the bottom and what commands you would need to find like that right restaurant on that list page of restaurants and so on. Then think about positive and negative space and size of proportion to create kind of like that sense of rhythm and dynamic flow within the application to kind of communicate, you know, what's the most important news story of today or what's the second and the third. Then you can annotate it with typography and say what font you want to use and what weights and colors. And then think about branding and annotate the sketch with, you know, what colors make sense for a children's game versus a business app. You know, these kind of things. Call that out on the application so you get a really good feel for the personality that when you go into visual design, you'd be able to reflect in those comps. Okay? So that is the layout session. I provided a couple of links here. There's actually a ton of information on layout, but I just provided two because they kind of link to all the other ones here. So one link for layout within the slides, if you go down, download the slides, and one for the hub control and how to design those hub pages. Looks here. So we've got a couple of questions. You spoke of a 20-pixel grid, but showed five. I can't see. It's kind
five
of cut
by
off.
Five and 4x5.
Okay.
4x4 of subunits.
Okay. Where does the 20 come into play? Well, we think about kind of the base unit being that 20-pixel grid, and then subunits being 5 pixels. So that 5-pixel grid being kind of the smallest atomic unit that you might use. And the 20 pixels, again, this is all about being able to scale through those different DPI plateaus that we're going to talk about in the windowing session. But it's a good place to start. If you use that consistently across the app, you're going to have a great experience when you go to supply that UI on different size screens and different DPI screens. And it's we use that 20 pixels and the 5 pixels because they scale across those plateaus as being whole numbers. But when you think about like 20 pixels versus 5 pixels, I mean, in some cases, you're going to see applications. If you look at my screen here, let's just go to like the news app. I mean, the related stories that you're going to see here, I mean, this is just a 10-pixel difference between these two, right? And they show the difference. And then a lot of these stories, like the separate columns, are going to be 4 units across, even though these are 2 subunits. It's just a unit system that we use to consistently lay out the apps on the grid across pages and across different apps. It's just a good unit to start with, built into the templates and scales really, really well. So do we have any more questions? Oh, it's coming up.
That's a new one.
I don't see it. Oh. Ah, how can we implement our own custom glyphs or icons? Is there any service to convert custom icons to a font? That's a great question. I mean, you can, of course, supply your own glyphs if you wanted to do custom glyphs for the app bar. When we talk about scaling in the next session, we'll talk about how to supply them so they look great across all the different scaling plateaus, and Windows will automatically substitute the right glyph in based on the scaling plateau of the app, or of the device. I'm not aware of a tool that would create a custom font for you.
No, but so when you would, so you don't only need a font to make a new glyph. Mm-hmm. So you can also just make something with some of the graphic tools.
Right.
Just use an image or a PNG.
Right.
That you can also make scalable, as we've seen in the other session. I don't know of a tool that can make a font out of it.
No. Yeah, I know. I worked on a project where there was our visual designer did create a font, and he just used whatever font authoring tools. I can't remember what the name of the tool was, but we shipped it as a font, and it did scale well and stuff like that. But I'm not it wasn't in Visual Studio Expression, so
no.
That's something you could probably look into and post up on my blog. Okay, so is there a simple way to query the device to get back its size and not just its resolution? You know, honestly, that's a great question that we're going to answer in the next session. So you'll probably just have to stick around after this 10-minute break, and right afterwards we'll come back and I'll answer that, because it's a really interesting conversation that we'll kind of build on as we're talking about screen size and then screen resolution. So any tips to get a nice logo for Windows 8 apps? We'll talk about logos in the store session. The biggest thing is making sure that they're clear and they scale really well, that you provide scaled sizes across the different plateaus. And we'll talk about that in the store session. I'm probably going to end up repeating a lot of stuff in the window session if I answer these now. But stay around for the session on windowing. We'll cover a lot of this. So any rules for the grid, or can we create our own grid? I would use that 20-pixel unit and 5-pixel subunit, but create a silhouette, you know, based on the silhouette based on your scenarios, and tune it according to the personality of your app. Have a consistent silhouette across all the pages, but I would use those units just because they scale so well.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, and that's our last question. So that is the layout session here at the Windows 8.1 UX Design Jumpstart. We're going to take a 10-minute break. We'll come back and we'll answer all those questions about windowing and scaling and so on in the windowing session. So thanks a lot.